John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one to another. Now, if you were here the last time I was here, you may have heard me tell how I rate my holidays. A quick review for those who were, may have forgotten. My top five are the three patriotics: July 4th, Veterans Day, Memorial Day, Labor Day, because that's my birthday, and Christmas. I've been asked, where does Thanksgiving fit in all that? Well, it's a very close number six. And at the exact opposite end of the scale, the holiday I loathe more than any other, Valentine's Day. Hate it, can't stand it, never liked it. Not because at age 53 I find myself still single. Hated it since I was a kid. You see, when I was a kid, I was Charlie Brown. Y'all know Charlie Brown, right? Thanksgiving, he was always waiting for that one Valentine from the cute little red-haired girl with curls. Never got it. That was me. Just never been a holiday I liked. Again, not that I haven't had my opportunities. I have. I've been engaged three times, never married, and there's a story behind each one of them. I don't mind love, I rather like it, and I'm okay with marriage. It's fine for those of you who are married, I'm sure it's a great thing. And I've done almost everything involved with weddings. I've performed a wedding. The lovely couple is still married, amazingly enough to me. I've even given the bride away in place of her father. I've done everything at weddings except be the groom. And I'm okay with that. My best friend always reminds me that for me, marriage is a fine, wonderful institution. I'm just not ready to be institutionalized. But there is that one day a year when the thoughts of the world turn to love and everything that's involved with it. And love is very important in the human experience. It has to be. After all, we are created by God in His image. And what is God? Love. We have no choice. We have to have love in our lives. We have to be able to experience love, to understand it, to want it, to desire it. The wisest man who ever lived, in his list of times for everything, even has it included. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verses 1 through 8, where he lists a time for everything. Time to be born, time to die, time to plant, time to pluck up. Eventually, and I find this slightly satisfying, eventually, right at the end, just before a time of war and a time of peace, he gets to a time to love and a time to hate. It's essential for all of us. It's an integral part of life as we know it. Life without love can't exist. Life and love will always be permanently attached. Today, as we get into that love mode, I'd like us to look at a few examples of love that the great lover, and by the way, such an awesome song. You guys know how to pick the right ones to get me right here. And for those of you who don't know, I've had the privilege and pleasure and honor of having a lot of the Bryant Trio songs for as long back as I can remember. So it's always nice to be able to hear them again. So I'd like today to take a trip through the Bible and consider some of the sayings of two of my favorite biblical writers as they talk about love. Now, the first one didn't actually write down a single word, but he said a lot and others wrote down for him. And so I'd like to consider, first off, some of the things that Jesus said about love. And his advice to us is that our love in our words, our love in our actions, is just not necessarily to be lavished upon those that we like. In fact, a wise man once said that what humans in their natural state process as love is typically not love, but something else. He said, in fact, that most times when a normal human says, "I love you," what they really mean is, "I love me. And I like you because you make me feel good." And that's usually in our unconverted state where it ends. And Jesus, as he was talking to his disciples about love, wanted to make very clear that it was just not to be given to those that we like, but especially to be given to those who don't like us. Luke chapter 6, verses 27 through 35, he says, "I say unto you which hear me, love your enemies, do good to those that hate you, bless those that curse you, and pray for those who despitefully use you. Unto him that smites you on one cheek, offer him the other. For him that takes away your coat, forbid him not to take your cloak. Give to every man that asks, and of him that taketh away thy goods, ask them not again. As ye would that men would do to you, do also to them likewise. For if we love those that love us, what thanks have we? Even the unconverted love those that love them." And if you do good to them that do good to you, what thanks do you have? For sinners even do the same. And if we lend to those from whom we hope to receive, what thanks have we? For sinners also lend to sinners to receive as much again. But love your enemies, and do good and lend, hoping for nothing again, and your reward shall be great, and you shall be the children of the highest. Love, then, if we're going to practice it truly, means reaching out to the people who can't stand the sight of us and still saying, I love you. What can I do for you? No matter the cost. Hard to do. I know, I struggle with it every day. It's easy to give love to people that like us or that we like. Easiest thing in the world is to be kind to someone who's kind back. Try that with someone who stands on the street corner and says in a very loud voice, that's the most horrible human I know. Makes a world of difference, though, if we can actually say, I hear you, and here's what I'm going to do for you. I'm going to give you the shirt off my back because you're cold. I'm going to feed you because you're hungry. That's love. Christ asks us to love others, not just when they're nice to us, but because they exist. And as much as he says we are to love other people, his requirement goes even further and says, not only do you have to love those around you, but you have to love me even more. Matthew chapter 10, verses 37 through 39, he says, he that loves his father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. He that loves sons or daughters more than me is not worthy of me. He that takes not his cross and follows after me is not worthy of me. For he that findeth his life shall lose it, and he that loses his life for my sake shall find it. Now, not being married and being from the older generation, I have no children of my own, so I don't know about that parental love thing. I have rent-a-kids. No, it's true. I have rent-a-children. It's a whole lot easier. You see, you can hang out with them and have that experience of adult and child fun and good times, and then when they're tired of you and you're tired of them, you can give them back to where they belong and keep on going. I have three rental children that I love as though they were mine, and I'm very proud of all of them. But as much as I love them, I fail in my responsibility to them if I love my Lord less. And that's his requirement. How many of you parents would die for your children? It's the natural thing. There's something about that parental child love that says, I will do whatever it takes to protect them, to care for them. That's why when crimes happen and mothers do things to their children or fathers do things to their children, that's why it shocks us so much, because it goes against every instinct we have for protection. And yet Jesus says, as much as you love them, if you love them more than me, you're not worthy of my love. You're not worthy of me as Lord and Master in your life. Puts a whole new spin on it, doesn't it? Love is not some easy thing. Love's hard. Love's difficult. If you thought love was just a walk in the park, ladies and gentlemen, guess again. It's the most difficult thing we'll ever do. The other half of his requirement for love from us can be found in Matthew chapter 22, verses 37 through 40. He says, "You will love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. That's the first and greatest commandment. The second is like it, you will love your neighbor as yourself." Now, I was good at math, I hated it in school, but even I can figure out that if you're supposed to love the Lord with all your heart, mind, and soul, that's first in line. If you're supposed to love your neighbor as yourself, that makes that second in line. So loving yourself is actually the third thing in the line of love. So if you love yourself more than your neighbor and more than your God, you've got it all backwards. If you want to really get deep into it, go to the book of John. And as Jesus is winding up his earthly ministry with his disciples, John chapter 13, chapter 14, he talks a lot in those chapters about love, what it means to love, what we're supposed to do and how to do it. Our scripture verse, where he tells us, "A new commandment, to love one another as he loved us." You know, in talking to his disciples, he says in one part that the greatest love in the world was manifest in laying down one's life for his friends. And then he immediately followed that verse up with these words, "Today, you are my friends." And I, as a younger man, could never figure out why the disciples didn't figure that part out as to what he was saying, because they still continued to argue amongst themselves as to who was going to be first in the kingdom when he overthrew the Romans. And I thought about it, they were with Jesus for 3.5 years. And in those 3.5 years, in all of his teachings about love and all that, they still hadn't gotten that connection. And then one bright morning, it hit me. And I feel rather ashamed because I've always looked down on the disciples for that, because they had Jesus for 3.5 years. And it took me 35 to figure it out. With all of the resources that I have available to me in the Bible and all the other spiritual books, it took me 10 times longer than the disciples to figure out he was talking to me. I have a very good friend that, to me, in frail human terms, best epitomizes that concept. And he will tell you that he is no hero. He will tell you to this day that he was just doing his job. But he came as close as I have ever seen anyone to dying to save his friends and companions. It took place in April of 1979 on a deserted stretch of Iranian desert sand. Those of you who know history know the story. Americans were being held hostage in the embassy in Tehran, and there was a rescue attempt put together to go get them and bring them back to safety. And they had landed in their first stopping place, and that is when the plan disintegrated. They determined that because of mechanical difficulties and other things, they didn't have enough helicopters to complete the mission, and so the decision was made to abort. And as all of the aircraft and helicopters were maneuvering to begin to take off and go back where they had come from without completing the mission, one of the helicopter rotors sliced through the back of a C-130 airplane that was filled with fuel. The sparks from the metal ignited the fuel, and the airplane exploded. 8 people lost their lives. 35 other people were badly injured, including my friend Jim. He was a loadmaster on the airplane that exploded, and he was standing at the back ramp. His job was to help get the folks back on the airplane seated where they belonged so that they could take off. And he was standing at the back ramp, and when the airplane exploded, it shot him out the door like a cannon. He impacted the side of the airplane that was next to them, broke his back in 3 places. Second and third degree burns on his body. And at that point, I would just have laid down and said, "Help, help." Jim, despite the pain, and he says, because of the adrenaline, didn't stay on the ground. He went back to his airplane to get people off, to try and put out the fire. Because he kept going with his broken back, it never healed properly. He was never able to fully regain physical function of his left arm. And he always sort of walked with a weird, snaky back. To this day, he never says anything about his actions, though everybody on that trip acknowledges him as one of the unsung heroes. He always talks about the other people that helped other people, never himself. That's as close as I can come. But our Creator, our Savior, went even further. He not only went back to rescue the people on this ugly, dark planet that hated him, he allowed himself to become what we deserved. We don't, by nature of our rebellion, deserve life. And yet he came here and said, it's okay. I love you. You're my friends. I'm going to die so you don't have to. My friend, the Apostle Paul, I think, tells it best. Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 8. He says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into the grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And we do so, but we glory in our tribulations, knowing that tribulation works patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And hope makes us not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit which is given to us. For when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet for a good man some might dare to die. But God commends his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Pretty heavy stuff. But that's the kind of love that has been given to each one of us. And that's the kind of love that Christ talked about when he talked about loving our neighbor as ourselves. Loving one another as he loved us. That's what we need to do. That's the standard for love. If you flip over to Romans chapter 8, he talks more about that. But he talks about it in the context of a relationship between God and us because of love. If you're like me, you've read these words over and over and over again. And they still have that same pull on me that they have when I read them long ago in Bible class when I was that high. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also then freely give us all things? Who will lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God who justifies us. Who is he that condemns us? It is Christ who died, yea, is rather risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us then from the love of Christ? Will tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or the sword? None of those things will separate us from Christ, because he already demonstrated his love by going beyond famine. By going beyond nakedness. He loved us so much. He took the walk down that twisty, windy road from the judgment hall to the place of shame outside the gates, and allowed himself to become our payment for sin. You know, Paul continues, no, In all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, or any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Today, as the world turns its thoughts toward love, and as we acknowledge amongst ourselves the fact that love is an essential part of our life, I'd like to end with a prayer that Paul spoke in a letter he wrote to the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Sutter Hill. Bet you didn't know you were in the Bible. If you turn with me to the book of Ephesians, chapter 3, you'll find there a prayer that Paul offers to the loved people he has in Ephesus. And it's an echo of the prayer that Christ has for each one of us today here in Sutter Creek, California. Paul says, beginning in verse 14, "For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in his love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is that breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God." Amen. This Thanksgiving, Valentine's Day. Thanks. See, I told you I don't like Valentine's Day. I can't even say it. That is my prayer, my hope, my wish for all of you, for myself, that today we will take those words and that we will all find that love of Christ which passes all knowledge, and that we will be filled with all of the fullness of God, and that we will live that full expression of love to our neighbors and to our world today and every day. The love that Christ showed to us, because he loved us so much that he came here, gave of himself, died the death that we deserve so that we may have life. Let's pray. Dear Father God, today here on earth, the world celebrates love as an essential part of our being, given to us by you, our Creator, who is, was, and always will be love in its fullest expression. Today, as we go through our day and as our thoughts are on you, I pray that you will give us that full understanding of love, that you will remind us again as you whisper into our hearts and our minds, "I love you," that we will truly know what that love is, what that experience of love from you can be, and that we will take that love and share it with our friends, our neighbors, and our world, so that when they look at us, they see not us, but you, true, pure love, shining out to them, that they will know that we are your disciples and that you have something special for them as you've had for us. I pray these things in the wonderful name of Jesus, who loved us so much. Amen.